You could see why the Raptors came here, because this is what the games used to look like, you know, back in the day. You couldn't get into some tournaments. It was like standing room only.
Finesse, try your best to diagnose. When I host, you get to roast, toast, baked, grilled, brawl. When I rumble, you crumble. My stuff is good like Morongo soup. Rappers getting soup front and rugged, while I'll unplug it with my somatics into nugget and expose.
What was it like? So tell me on like game day, right? What was it like going? No, I'm serious. And just give me the whole sensory experience, because I've never experienced anything like this. I mean, when you walked in the game, what was that like at Eastern, where the fans must have just been crazy?
That's for sure. Yeah. Yes. And there wasn't sitting or standing room in the gym, so everybody was up on the balcony.
Wow.
Feet over the railings, leaning over. It was well, our gym wasn't even regulation size, so the balconies certainly weren't regulation size.
Right.
But it was packed. You would fit as many students as possible in there.
Yeah.
Parents and during the middle of the game, you would be shooting and somebody would open the doors so the students in the hallways could watch the game.
Really? Because there was just not enough room inside.
No, and the three-point line was out the door. Yeah. So you would be shooting and there would be the students in the hallway coming in, cheering, and wow, going up to try to find a seat. It was amazing. Girls and boys, yeah, basketball. Yeah. It was so much fun. There's nothing like it.
So were there people from different generations too? Was it intergenerational?
Definitely. If you went to Eastern, you're Eastern for life.
Yeah.
Whether you're even the grade 6, 7, 8s who know they're going to Eastern, it's Eastern. I'd been in Eastern's gym since I was 9 or 10.
Yeah, yeah. I was, after every boys game, because her brothers were older, so after every boys game, her and her sister would be on the floor shooting. It was always a joke, because her dad would always come to me and be like, yeah, you're gonna coach my daughter. I'm like, she's 9, like, no way.
But yeah, it's Eastern for life. It's a community and it goes far beyond basketball.
Yeah.
It made me who I am as a basketball player today, but also as a person.
I mean, I think that, well, for one, Eastern, the community of Eastern is very rich in its traditions. And what I love most about it is that although you left, you still came back. You know, you really had a sense of belonging,
right,
within,
right,
the community, that, you know, people accepted you for who you were on the basketball, yeah, court and nothing else. You know, at that school especially, all that really mattered is, can you perform? Can you not perform? Right. It had nothing to do with the color of your skin or where you grew up,
yeah,
or,
amazing,
you know, who you did. Like, because Eastern is a school that took kids from everywhere. Like,
right,
like your last year had a kid from Brooklyn, or Durham region. We had kids from the West End. We had kids from downtown. She was, you know, she's in Eastern's catchment, so she walks to school every day. Like, we, you know, you had a sense of what the city really looked like, mm, in a lens,
mm-hmm,
because everybody went there for one particular reason,
yeah,
or another. And that's just the basketball community side. There's also the Muslim community that was heavily represented at Eastern as well. So you got like a different look of kids who don't even play sports,
yeah,
and what do they do? How do, yeah, they interact? And, yeah, how do they get along? So it was really like a really cool learning experience on, okay, how to navigate within our city. I always feel that Canada has that luxury over America because there's so many nationalities.
Yeah.
And I think that with community that you learn how to, coexist.
I think there's something really special about basketball that I don't think is reflected in any other kind of sport in the city of Toronto.
Why is that? What do you mean?
You know, maybe it's a real contrast, and maybe there's a whole context to be understood. But, you know, newcomer Canadians and immigrant Canadians and, you know, people of color have, you know, kind of bought into something that I don't think other sports like hockey and cricket, sports that have been traditionally very exclusionary,
mm-hmm,
into the fold and into how we kind of understand how the city kind of changes and develops.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, the context is that the 1960s and the 1970s were kind of it's one of the most outstanding times of change in the GTA, at least, but mostly in Canada. You know, up until that time, there was no significant amounts of immigration. But as families started to come to this country, it was really a kind of an experiment in how they kind of got themselves introduced,
yeah,
not just to the city itself, but to other folks that they wouldn't have seen otherwise. And, you know, it was cricket for some, to some extent, but really there's a real connection, especially with younger generation Canadians over this game. And it's not even just a matter of Black culture or an expression of immigrant culture. It's kind of a broad statement about how people can come together and find this game, find how they connect with each other, and have it become kind of a bridging point for other things.
Today is the launch of the Muslim Western Basketball League. I'm just enjoying the moment, to be honest, because it's a project that has been long in the making and thought about, and to just see everyone just having fun doing their own thing and being introduced to the sport of basketball in a space where they feel included and belonged is just awesome. When I came to Canada, I discovered the sport of basketball. I played so many sports, but I felt like basketball was the one I felt included, although I didn't see other people that looked like me. But the fact that I saw so many diverse groups of people on the court that treated me well and accepted me as who I am, and I kind of made it my mission to do something for women in basketball. But later on down the line, I realized that it was going to be heavily related to my identity as a Muslim woman. I think there's a lot of stories I want to tell through Muspil. I hope to, I hope that's heard in the most authentic way, because I feel like basketball is the way that we're, I guess I'm hoping to get that across to the world.
Yeah, I was thinking a little bit about, what Perry was saying about just basketball being such a part of like experiences for immigrants, right? I immigrated from Hong Kong here when I was eight years old. This was like 92. And there was a huge influx at the time of immigrants coming from Hong Kong, coming from Asia. And I grew up in Markham, and it was a completely different experience from you, because I walk into the class and it was like 80% Chinese.
That's really
right. And it's like a strange experience because you don't know anybody here. Like I didn't barely spoke the language when I came here, had to go to ESL.
Yeah.
But yet you're growing up with people that are like kind of having that similar experience as you, right? And like a lot of us connected through just talking about basketball. And you talk about the Raptors coming in like 95.
Yeah.
And like that became such a connection point for so many kids growing up, right? And like for me personally, like I remember when my dad came here, when we came here, my dad's like, you need to get into extracurricular activities.
So you play piano?
I definitely play piano. And I purposely played terribly so I wouldn't have to.
Me too. I got fired
it.
From piano lessons.
Yeah.
It was the most liberating day of my life. Yeah. I was like, I've been fired.
No,
like,
the best thing to get out of things you don't want to do is just tank.
Yeah.
Like, you just completely tank. But my dad's like, you got to be like legit, like part of like the community, right? Like you got to try to meet people through like extracurriculars. I didn't think about this stuff until like maybe now or later of like, oh, like basketball was actually this like huge thing that like connected me. And I think about too, like me working in like sports media and like covering the Raptors and things like that, right? If there wasn't a basketball team here, like I probably wouldn't even be in sports media, right? Like, cause like someone that looks like me, like how do I get into say like the hockey market or even the baseball market, right? Because so much of it isn't just about like what you know, but it's also like the fan base that you're interacting with, right? Because I know like when I do my work, I'm interacting with a lot of different communities.
Alex and Will co-host the Raptors show on Sportsnet Radio and Sportsnet 360.
I think one of the things we always think about too for the show is just what the fans are talking about and what they want to hear, right? Like I think that's one of the very important drivers of the show.
I'm your host, Wing Lu. I'm joined by producer and co-host Alex Wong for a record-setting fourth straight day in studio. You know, we're bringing back a popular segment that we did last season, which was to do Twitter questions.
All right, non-basketball question.
All right.
What is the GOAT food court restaurant, Will?
what a transition. Like Shanghai 360, obviously. You know what I mean?
What do you mean, obviously? I've never heard of that place. What? But I just like to get a street dog, you know?
Oh,
it's hard for me to say no when I see a hot dog truck on the street.
Oh, know? Man.
That's my kryptonite. Shout out to my mom. My mom left for Hong Kong today for a vacation. You know, some of us wake up at 4 in the morning to watch the World Cup, and some of us wake up at 3 in the morning to 2 in the morning to watch Raptors show. That's what my mom's going to be doing.
Really?
No, she's going to catch it on the YouTube stream.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah.
Alex, what's your bet for the longest deep squat Nick does this season And this person has kindly attached a clip from the Nets game that they went to. I think this is in Brooklyn, where Nick squatted for a full minute. He literally clocked him
in
the same way I clocked you trying to get out the parking lot yesterday. Yeah.
Did you feel, though, when Eastern closed in 2015, right?
Yeah.
Shut down 2015?
Like yeah. Yeah.
What void did that leave?
I think what happened was when Eastern closed, an era died. An era of how basketball is being played in our province, it died.
Yeah.
Because it immediately switched over and went to like the prep school route, which in the what I laugh about it is Eastern was a prep school. What I see is these situations, these prep situations, they mimic what Eastern did.
Tried to do, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Or yeah, well, what they've done.
Yeah.
So, you know, Eastern boys team especially have gone to China, Japan, wow. Italy. You know, they go to, you know, when Sami was going to school, they were going to US tournaments like 4 or 5 times a year. Nike gave them a $50,000 contract yearly for shoes and gear and whatnot. So all of these prep schools now that and AAU programs, that's exactly how they're baiting kids in.
Right.
Right. That's now the standard. Before it was the luxury. Now, if I don't have, what shoe brand are you with now?
Yeah.
Are you on the Nike circuit? Are you on the Under Armour circuit? Are you in the Adidas gauntlet? Are you in this? And based on your answers is how I'm choosing what team I'm playing for. Not, well, you know, this group has, you know, really good players, or, you know, these are my friends over here. Right.
But the community piece, it seems to me then, is starting to, or at least as I'm listening to you, is it starting to fragment a little? Because it strikes me that the opportunity was always that this was about community building, not just the elite athletes on the floor. The elite athletes on the floor gave us the chance to celebrate and be together and to be in the stands and to be cheering and to be clamoring to get in. Is that something we should be lamenting?
I think so. I mean, like Kareem, I'm lamenting the loss of all these institutions. There are examples in the GTA of public schools, and maybe that's where we should be going with it, of public schools providing this so-called prep service, this program that is within, you know, within those walls. And Central Tech, I think Central Tech is a really good example as well, where we see and understand what having this take place in a public space represents. And it represents equal opportunity and equal access, better education, that kind of thing. You're providing an opportunity for folks that wouldn't otherwise consider it or have a harder time accessing these things rather than getting baited in by an AAU program or from some other entity. You know, and, you know, for those who still continue to serve in public schools and provide these kind of programming services, you know, it's an upward battle. You know, you're being outcompeted by dollars and cents, honestly, and opportunity.
So me personally, I grew up in a low income area. So for me, we didn't have much growing up. I didn't have much. So the basketball courts, that was my place to be free. You know, you give me a basketball and I there's an immense sense of freedom and liberation that I get being a point guard and dribbling the ball up the court that I haven't found anywhere else. And growing up in a low income area and being able to play basketball on a regular basis, that became part of me. And when I became an older Muslim woman and I chose to wear the hijab, I didn't want to separate myself from that part of me. I'm going to be a basketball player, but I'm going to be a Muslim woman, and it's going to go hand in hand, and I'm going to make it work.
I feel like the community has grown, and it's grown into an industry now, where basketball was community-based in, you know, the early 2000s and back.
Yeah.
Now it's become more an industry. I think what has made it was the Weed in the North campaign. Because it allowed the country to attach itself to the game, but in an industry type of way.
Right.
You know, Leo Routon talks about it all the time. When he first was with the Raptors, you're driving around, there's no hoops anywhere.
Right.
And now there's 5-6 hoops on every street. Right. So I feel like where the community has changed in is that the Raptors coming in was a great thing, but it was also a thing where we didn't know that it was going to turn into an industry, because if it didn't, the Raptors would leave. Because there's no financial gain. It's kind of with the Grizzlies, right? There was no financial gain at that time.
So, Alex, you're looking at the the origins of the Raptors, right?
I've been working the last year on a book about the first year of the Raptors, and then some of the themes, you know, from talking to people diving in is about community, right? Like how the Raptors interacted with these communities. And like a lot of things I learned, I didn't even know. Like they had a Raptor ball program where they went into the different communities and like they assign basically community leaders, right? So in the Chinese community, in the Sikh community, Jamaican community, like they found people who were into basketball, who were already organizing locally in these places, and they gave them the resources to be able to kind of put together these camps, right? Like for kids who can come and play on weekends and things of that nature. And, you know, diving into, like for me personally, understanding kind of things that are happening in the Chinese community, right? Like one of the organizations I started in 95 was CCYA, which is this nonprofit youth association. And their goal was to have these weekend runs for kids who just wanted to play, right? And you guys talked about, you know, the elite athletes and like the prep schools and stuff, right? And like, you know, as someone who shot one for 10, free throws, I'm here to represent the civilians. But I think those efforts locally is in those communities is what you're talking about when you talk about giving opportunity to kids who just want to get into the sport, who just want to make friends, get to know people, and maybe not think about, you know, making it to college or making it to the pros. And I think there's a lot of value there as well.
I mean, in trying to understand how things have evolved over time and what basketball looks like now, the community is still there. Mm-hmm. They're not disappeared. They've just been set aside in favor of maybe a vision or a direction for the sport to develop. And it's prime upon us, whoever makes decisions out there, to invest in these communities in the proper way, to encourage parents and coaches and teachers too. You know, broad bastions of people who have interests in these things, but you know, and want to engage in the sport, but have a difficult time getting started. You know, everything from training programs to, you know, mentorship and leadership programs, all these things have a role to play in terms of how the sport is deployed. And, you know, for communities who have not been invested in over a span of time, you know, they're going to do it anyway.
But it's also about public space too, right? I mean, you alluded to this, that, you know, in a city like Toronto, a real treasure are the public spaces that we have. And some of them are, you know, the courts that are available and so on. Like, Sami, when you were growing up, you played obviously in gyms. You had terrific coaches in gyms and so forth. But tell me about like the public spaces. Were you also shooting hoops in the parks and stuff like that? Were you going out looking for runs around the city as well?
Not too much. I was playing every other sport possible growing up. So when I wasn't with my basketball team, I was on another school team.
Yeah.
But it's funny you mentioned that. I was kind of, during COVID, how a lot of the rims were off or locked. But when things started opening up, I would go to the Esplanade.
Yeah.
And every Saturday morning, there would be hundreds of people there from 6 years old to 60.
Yeah.
And you would get your five and we would play all day. So that was 2020.
Yeah.
And that's how I trained for my pro season. We couldn't be in the gym.
Right.
So I shot before when nobody was at the court. And then when everybody came, I played pickup basketball.
Right.
And it's still alive. Last summer, day after work, on the weekends, everybody goes to play pickup, Harborfront, Christie Pitts.
But some of these spaces, though, I mean, like when we think about public goods, we think of public goods, public schools, you know, public programs as a way of creating a level playing field, right? To create, to be accessible to everyone. But you know, having gone and watched a lot of runs in parks and so on, you know that some parks, the courts are pretty bad. I mean, and given all the benefits we've talked about in terms of how basketball is just such a, you know, it's a way to build communities. We want a city like Toronto, a city region like Toronto or Canada more generally to be knit together in these very positive ways. You know, why aren't we making the kinds of investments? It strikes me as not being particularly onerous to be making these kinds of investments in these public spaces that are intended to be for the public, right? These are collective goods. These aren't private goods or individual goods.
I think the tragedy is that the city doesn't work harder to maintain their own facilities. You know, Trinity Bellwoods is a very old community center. Rose Avenue, old community center, John Innes, old community center, and don't get the maintenance that the new community center down by City Place receives. But that's only because it's brand new. The money that's in that area generates the maintenance of that community center. There's also two schools that are attached to it. So there's a reason for it. You know, a school like Eastern Commerce, Essential Tech, Harvard, you know, all the schools in the downtown region especially do not get the maintenance that they need.
A dark, small gym. Honestly, I've spent so many hours in that hot, dark, dimly lit gym. And you're amazed because you're like, how did so many great basketball players come out of that gym? Like, how did that happen? It's small. Like, you're shooting an NBA three from the other three free throw line.
You know, hearing all this stuff right now kind of, you know, it kind of sounds like it's coming to the end. You know what I mean? It's really, really like a sad thing. But, I mean, too many good memories, though. You know, like, too many good memories, great players, great everything. You know, I'll never trade this experience for anything.
Eventually it'll fade and it'll be a little bit of a mythical tale maybe of, you know, of what high school basketball used to be like in the city. But hopefully we can capture it and keep sharing that story over and over so it can inspire somebody in some small way.
In light of our conversation today, what is the one thing that you want to do to pay it forward, to think about what an even brighter future might look like? So does anyone want to go first?
I'll go first.
Go.
I mean, I'm always concerned about community health and, you know, health of the nation. You know, when we're talking about how, you know, organizations like Basketball Canada and other, you know, entities are emphasizing long-term models that emphasize the first principle is community health and make sure the health of the nation is sustained. I think we need to coalesce better understanding of what that requires. And that requires maybe like a charter of play, similar to how countries like Finland mm-hmm. have put together maybe like a passenger bill of rights, the equivalent of having a set amount of criteria that is in place that gives organizations maybe a lead or at least an informational point of reference in terms of forming sport policies in their communities. Okay. And then translating those things in a really rapid way. I think that would actually get people to pay attention.
Yep.
Because there's a complacency crisis of sorts. Like, kids are not playing, you know, unless they're playing elite sports, which right. is part of this, you know, this ongoing crisis of
bifurcation,
and public goods. So if there's a way to emphasize and implement something that makes sense on a broad scale, and knowing that Canada is a very regional place, that yep. there are different, you know, different priorities in place.
I think one thing we've lost about sports now is everybody wants to be elite. Right. Everybody wants to be the best and be a pro when they're five. Right. And I think it's important to have the game be fun for as long as possible. And when it's time, if you are able to go on that path to become elite, then you take that path. And if not, it doesn't mean the sport is over for you. Like, I'm still playing, but you all love the game and you're not a pro.
Right.
And I will still love the game. And hopefully in 30 years, I'm talking about how much I love it and I'm involved with it still.
I think for me, like, it's thinking about like a lot of things we talked about today, like the impact that we all individually can have on people that we might not recognize. Like Perry, with your storytelling, like Sami, you playing basketball and having maybe younger kids look up to you in a way. And obviously everything you've talked about with your coaching and everything, it's like, you know, for me personally, I think about like, you know, when I tell a lot of these stories in the community, it's just about like creating visibility and letting people know that these communities exist, or like thinking about like one-on-one conversations and impact that you can have through basketball. Because, you know, I think a lot of times we think very big picture about community and things that we want to fix. And I think all those things are really important. But I think as I've gotten older, I've come to recognize too that like everyone, like all of us in these positions that we're in the basketball space, like, we are influencing people.
You know, our industry and our country is growing. You know, really, like for basketball, it's been since 95 till now. You know, so how do we continuously grow the game and provide more opportunities for kids to play at all levels?
I see a great opportunity for a university. I mean, the University of Toronto is a public university. right? Look at all the space we have here. We're talking about space. We're talking about community building. The University of Toronto, as with, you know, almost all universities in Canada, have a terrifically, wonderfully diverse student body, faculty and staff from around the world. It's the lab in which we can be doing all of the things that you're talking about today, right? And here we are in Hart House, which is a historic building. It's the heartbeat of the student life of the university. As I think about the future, I think about a space like this. And if you look around, it is beautiful. A space like this to bring together hoops, community, public space, and the kind of diversity that we've all been talking about. So I don't know, let's, a couple of us here from U of T, I mean, between the five of us, could we imagine an annual run here at Hart House? Are you a little bit nervous now?
A little bit, yeah.
Okay, so this, if you're indexing your nervousness right now, right? So say when you're shooting for Team Canada, that's 100. What is this right now?
I'm probably more nervous now than I am for in game.
Did you hear that?
Yes. Don't ever tell you that.